Before we continue with the rest of the video, we could use your help. Click that like button to help spread the word about Watch JoJo, and also be sure to subscribe and click the notification bell so you don't miss our future videos. A photographer took these shots of Native Americans a century ago. What they reveal is amazing. It was, declared the New York Herald, the most gigantic undertaking since the making of the King James edition of the Bible. But for 30 years, Edward S. Curtis traversed North America documenting its native tribes. Some said it couldn't be done. To make a lasting record of the lives and traditions of hundreds of Native American tribes would, they claimed, take an entire lifetime. And they were almost right. Despite the limited technology at the time, Curtis's collection of portraits are truly stunning. His photographs feature sage chiefs staring into the middle distance and long-lost tribes performing age-old customs in ceremonial dress. And equally as fascinating and culturally valuable are the pictures that show Native Americans going about their day-to-day lives at work, play, and rest. In fact, Curtis's photographs are remarkable in that they give us a priceless insight into not just another time, but another world altogether. The photographer's work would take an enormous toll, both personally and professionally. But thanks to him, we have a lasting record of a way of life that's all but disappeared. In fact, Curtis's magnum opus, The North American Indian, remains one of the most important works on North American history and ethnography. Yet, curiously, his passion for the Native Americans was born by complete accident. The story begins in 1898, just 30 years after Curtis was born and a little over a decade after he started work as an apprentice photographer in St. Paul, Minnesota. Curtis was out taking pictures of Mount Rainier in Wisconsin when he became involved in the rescue of a group of lost mountaineers. And as fate would have it, among this expedition were some leading experts on Indian ethnography. Nobody knows what the group, which included the head of the U.S. Biological Survey, C. Hart Merriman, and the famous conservationist and historian, George Bird Grinnell, talked about as they came down from the mountain. But within 2 years, Curtis was joining his new friends on expeditions across the country. Most notably, he was appointed the designated photographer when the group set out to visit the Blackfeet tribe of Montana and document their Sundance ceremony. And as it turns out, Curtis had actually photographed Native Americans before. Indeed, he snapped this portrait of Princess Angeline, otherwise known as Kiki Somlo, back in 1896. And today, it's credited with being among his finest works. Curtis had shown promise from an early age. At just 12 years old, he had actually begun constructing his very own camera from war spoils and secondhand parts. And it wasn't long before the young photographer was making a name for himself in his chosen field, picking up the bronze award at the National Photographers Convention in 1896. During the first years of the century, as his star was still rising, the photographer worked from a studio in Seattle. Later, however, he would purchase bigger premises where he and his wife Clara would raise a family. And eventually, even Curtis's parents-in-law had moved in and were lending a hand in the photography studio. But while many would have been content with this life, Curtis's ambitions proved to be far greater than running a family business in Seattle. And so, in 1906, he approached banking mogul J.P. Morgan with an interesting proposal. Initially, Morgan was skeptical of the young photographer, despite having been introduced to him by the president himself. In fact, it was only when Curtis showed him his photograph that the banker realized he was onto something special. In the end, he agreed to put up $75,000 to fund Curtis's project, a collection of books detailing the Native American life. And with contract in hand, Curtis began recruiting assistants. Among his team of leading academics was Frederick Webb Hodge, a celebrated writer and anthologist from the Smithsonian, who would edit Curtis's work. Work on the massive project soon got underway. In the first instance, Curtis would send out a team before him to carry out initial studies on the chosen tribe. And upon their return, they would brief their boss, who would then visit the tribe himself to perform his own investigations. But in doing so, Curtis would be away from home for several months at a time. And before too long, J.P. Morgan's $75,000 began to run thin. Over time, Curtis developed 25 cardinal points that he felt would allow him to complete a thorough investigation into the Native American life. And his method worked. Ultimately, the photographer succeeded in carrying out the most extensive studies ever made. because as well as photographing the faces and clothes of his subjects, Curtis and his team also documented their religious beliefs and their marital practices, as well as their traditional ceremonies around birth and death. Curtis's studies were made all the more extraordinary by the fact that, in many cases, the photographer was able to encourage tribes who had never even spoken to a white person before to open up to him. And not only did these tribes welcome him into their communities, but they also came to call him the Shadow Catcher because of his uncanny ability to capture the very essence of their lives and traditions. In 1904, the Seattle Times ran a report on the revolutionary photographer in which they noted his mysterious ability to go amongst the Indians and get that which they're determined not to reveal has brought him a letter from the highest Indian authority in the United States. And this incredible letter, the newspaper added, commanded every Indian chief to do everything in his power to carry out the wishes of Mr. Curtis. But it wasn't only fantastic photographs that Curtis captured. In fact, over his lifetime, the adventurer made some 10,000 Edison wax cylinder recordings of traditional Indian music, and he documented their unique languages too. Tragically, however, this medium was notoriously fragile, and many of Curtis's valuable recordings were destroyed by dust, humidity, and high temperatures. A precious sample of these audio documents are, however, still usable today, and they're currently being held at the University of Indiana. Their value cannot be underestimated either. Yes, in some cases, these are the only remaining recordings of languages no longer spoken, or music no longer played. In the years after the Great War, money became tighter and interest in grand anthropological adventures waned. And so, despite the initial hopes of Morgan and Curtis, no major publisher made an offer for the work. Nevertheless, Curtis persevered with his project, armed with even more funds from Morgan and several other elite backers. By 1915, Curtis had published the 10th volume of the North American Indian, which focused on documenting only one Native American tribe, the Kwakoutl Indians. But his professional achievements came at an immense personal cost. In 1916, his wife Clara eventually tired of his extended travels and filed for divorce. And unfortunately, Curtis would have to wait another 11 years before he saw all his four children and his ex-wife again. In all, Curtis produced an incredible 222 sets of photographs. He snapped more than 40,000 pictures in more than 80 Native American tribes and documented countless audio recordings too. It's little wonder then that the finished collection of the North American Indian was declared both a photographic and an anthropological masterpiece, although sadly it was one that Curtis himself would not benefit from financially. Why? Because in 1935, Morgan sold the rights to the works, depriving the photographer of any royalties. Today, Curtis's works are held at several libraries and archives, including the Curtis Library at Northwestern University. And thanks to the recent digitization of volumes, readers all around the world can now marvel at the photographer's work and celebrate his incredible achievements. Curtis died in Los Angeles in 1952 at the age of 84. In his New York Times obituary, he was credited with being an internationally known authority on the history of the North American Indian. And his legacy lives on. Thanks to his incredible photographs, a lost way of life has been remembered and conserved for many generations to come. Please don't forget to subscribe and activate the bell to receive everything that's new.